Alright, so in this video, let's take a look at these BK Precision oscilloscopes. These are 100 megahertz, two-channel oscilloscopes with a built-in function generator. If that sounds like a lot, that's okay, because you can only use little bits and pieces of this and it'll still work perfectly fine, even if you don't use all of it. So just as a general overview, you have your two input probes here, you have your function generator output, and you have an external trigger, which you don't need to worry about for this. That's pretty out there stuff. Up here at the top, you have your power button. At the back, you have here your power port. Don't got to worry about those guys. And the way the function, well, the way oscilloscopes are set up is very similar. It's also these little flip-out feet you can put up if you want to have it stand up like this. But oscilloscopes, fortunately, are very similar to each other in how they work. So you can take a look on here, the controls. You have a whole bunch of buttons and knobs and stuff, and it might look a little bit intimidating, but for right now we can ignore all these, and just focus on, ignore these two, just on these boxes right here. So you can see here that each of these channel inputs has a corresponding knob here, a button here, a knob here. And that's important because you can see that they're color-coded, so that's yellow and that's blue and that's yellow. That's yellow and that's blue. So blue on this side, yellow on that side. So these controls are referencing this particular input, and same for this one. This box over here controls your timescale. So that kind of gets into what oscilloscopes are. So let me turn on the oscilloscope and show you what it's all about. So the oscilloscope button, or the on button's at the top. Just press that in and it'll start doing its little, that screen you saw is normal. It's okay. It's supposed to do that. You didn't break it. I promise. Okay, so this is what it looks like when it's turned on. And this kind of gets into what oscilloscopes are in general. So in the last video, we talked about multimeters. A multimeter is good for measuring higher voltages, currents, but the downside of the multimeter, if you turn it on here, you can see that it's only updating that screen a couple times a second, and it's not keeping a history. It does have a min-max feature, which does keep like a record of the highest and lowest voltages it saw. But all in all, even with all that, it's only updating a couple times a second. This oscilloscope updates about a billion times a second. So it's like a multimeter on steroids. It's super duper fast, but it's also super duper expensive compared to a multimeter. So you might also start up your oscilloscope and notice that it's kind of in a weird state. Like, I got all this crazy stuff running on it, and it would be kind of a pain to go through and just turn everything off manually. So what you can do instead is you want to go to the button right here that says save and load. Click on that. It'll give you this menu up here. At the bottom, you have factory. When you press that, it's going to undo all these crazy changes and get it back to where it was before. And then you can press menu on off, and you can see it's basically where it was, where we started. So what I've done here is I've taken the oscilloscope and removed everything from it. I've turned all the special features off. So right now it's just running as simple as it can get. And what it does essentially is it is a multimeter, sort of, that measures voltage over time and it gives you a XY graph of that. And to do that, it uses a different type of probe. In this case, it doesn't use these two probes here. It uses this with an alligator clip. Now, an important distinction to make is that this alligator clip is not a negative probe, like from the multimeter. I have a whole video of that, which I can link in to this. But you need to be careful where you plug this alligator clip into with certain devices. But the stuff you're going to be working on, probably don't got to worry about it. But you can see here it has this jack here that you plug in. It's called a BNC. That just plugs in right into here. It needs to push in a little bit and then you turn it until it locks into place. Let me show you here. You can see how it kind of lines up with that tab right there and then turn. And now the probe is attached. But before we use the probe, let's make sure that the settings on the probe are correct. It's, like again, a little bit more complicated than a multimeter. You have specifically this switch here with 1x, 10x, and then ref. You don't have to worry about what these do for right now. Just make sure that your probe is set to 1x, okay? On top of that, you need to make sure that your meter also knows that this is set to 1x. Fortunately, these meters can't auto-detect that because that's a much more expensive feature. So what you want to do is click on the channel 1, because our probe is plugged into channel 1. You'll see this window up here, and you can see right over here, this middle box here says probe and then X1. Now, if that's not set to X1, what you've got to do is just press this button, and you'll see this little other window appear. You also might have seen this little light appear here. I can do that again to show you. So, press this button, the light turns on, and then the window here appears. That means that you can use this knob to select one of these. So, you just want to select x1, and then press in the knob. Like that. So the light will turn off, and the window will disappear, and you can see it's set to x1. Now you can hit this menu on-off button, and that'll clear out the menu. So now we can actually do some measurements, and fortunately our oscilloscope comes with a little calibration device here. It comes with these two little metal pieces, and the one on this side is going to be a square wave output, and the other is going to be a ground. So what we want to do is take our oscilloscope, our probe for oscilloscope, hook up the alligator clip to the ground, and then hook up the probe port to the signal. And you can see that it looks a little bit weird. And what you can try doing is try pressing the auto button. And you can see that it's taken the settings and made a guess as to what you're trying to look at and set the settings to that. So you can click menu on off, and you can see that's a square wave that's being sent out by this little pin here. Now, something to keep in mind is that the auto button is not a guarantee. When you press that, it's not always going to figure out what you're trying to look at. If it's a weird complex signal, it might lock onto something wrong, or it'll just not give you the right signal that you're looking for. So it's just there to get it back, you know, get a range of where it should be. And from there, you can adjust it even further. So here you can see a square wave that's coming out of this probe, and we can adjust this and just sort of show, like, we can measure it, we can change how it looks on the display. So on this side here, we have our two knobs. The little knob up here is for position, so it's taking the graph and just moving it up and down like this. If you click the button in, it will reset back to zero. In this case, it's offset a bit, so we can lower it back down here. And you can see as we lower it, this number over here changes. I'll do it again. So you see how that's channel 1 equals negative 1.5 volts. So that means that our graph, if you think back to like algebra, it's taking our graph and just shifting it down on the y-axis. The big knob underneath that controls the voltage. So this is going to determine how sensitive our probe is to voltage. So you can see as I turn the knob all the way to the left, the signal gets very small. It's showing 10 volts. So each one of these little blocks in here represents 10 volts. So because our signal is tiny, it's not really showing much, but we can zoom it back in. That's what you can kind of think of this like, as zooming in on a certain axis. So we're making the y-axis bigger. So I'll set it to 1 volt. So each one of these boxes is 1 volt. So you can see the signal coming into this is just about 3 volts, just a little under it. But if you remember before, we were messing with this knob, which changes the origin point of this signal. So if we press it in, it will set it back to zero. So now this line right here represents 0 volts, 1 volt, 2 volt, 3 volts. And so the signal coming out of this is a DC square wave of 0 volts to just under 3 volts. So that's only half of the graph. We can also adjust the knob over here for horizontal. We were just changing the vertical stuff, but if we change horizontal, the small knob up here will shift the graph back and forth like this. And if we click this in, it will reset back to zero. And the knob underneath of that controls the time. So we're effectively zooming in and zooming out on the time here. So now I set the division to 20 microseconds 20 milliseconds per division, which means that each one of these little blocks here corresponds to 20 milliseconds. And I can zoom out even more. So now it's 1 second per division. So now each one of these blocks represents 1 second. So it's gonna take a while for this to fill in. You can see it's just slowly creeping in there at one block per second. Or I can zoom it way in. So that's 200 microseconds, 100 microsecond. And now we're into the nanoseconds. So that's 2 nanoseconds per division. So each one of these blocks represents 2 nanoseconds. So that's way too fast for this graph, but you can see as we adjust this, we can get an idea of what the signal looks like and how it looks in terms of like the rising edge. So this is where oscilloscopes really come in handy is, for example, this is not, even though this looks to be like a square wave, if we zoom into it, you can see that it's not really a square wave. It's got this rise time to it. So what you thought was instant is actually taking a little bit of time, in this case, just under like 3 microseconds to reach the high level. Something that a multimeter, for example, would never be able to pick up. But there's also some pretty advanced tools with this. So for example, up here we have the measure button. If you click on that, it will give us some things, it'll give us some tools we can use to measure things. So here I have the options here. So I have voltage, time, and clear. Voltage and time just correspond to the X and Y axis, or the vertical and horizontal. So time would be horizontal, voltage would be vertical. So for example, I can press voltage and then show like peak to peak. So this will show a little window up here and measure what our peak to peak value is of the signal. Or we can go back if I press the measure button again and press time. Here I have frequency. So if I press that, it'll add another little thing here and start trying to guess what the frequency is. But you can see right here, the oscilloscope is not able to see past this graph. So it sees this, but it doesn't. That's not enough to give you a frequency. It has to go at least one cycle to be able to give you a frequency. So if I zoom it back out by using the horizontal button or horizontal knob, the big knob, you can see that this signal coming out of this is 1 kilohertz. But if I zoom in too far, it doesn't figure it out because there's no beginning and end to this. But as soon as it finds a beginning and an end, it can show you what the frequency is.